allow the people on this planet that make the biggest difference know how to keep updating and refocusing their obsessions. As I drive down the road of my life, as the road changes, as I go over bridges, as there's floods, as there's storms, as there's problems, as I run out of fuel, as I go on this trip, as life changes and as opportunities come and go, I have to get obsessed with the new part of this adventure, knowing it is the destination that I want. Look, it's challenging. I know it's challenging, but you have to redefine who you are all the time and refuel this new obsession as conditions change, as your life changes, as you grow and as you mature, and your previous goals are achieved, and maybe even as those old goals no longer entice and excite you. Look, this is going to determine this ability to transition your obsessions on how much you get done in your time on this planet. It is you continuing to recreate who you really are and what you should really be obsessed about today. The key to tying your obsession to your purpose is to always set new goals for yourself. Never be satisfied. Never, ever be satisfied. What happens to the guy that retires or the gal that retires? They're bored. They're irritable. Look, just get around them for a couple weeks. They're bored. They're irritable. They're angry. They're critical. Why? Because they're not working. There's no new game. Look, if I just had $1 million, how many times have you heard this? If I just had $1 million, I'd retire and play golf every day. Then the guy gets there, plays golf every day for 5 hours, becomes a 10 handicap, or an 8, or 6, or 5, watches TV the rest of the day, watches other golfers that are negative 10s. And hates his life, drinks too much beer, eats bad food, sits in a lazy boy that's paid for, brags about the house that he's lived in for, I don't know, 38 years. That ain't life, man. That's prison. And that's why you're unhappy. And that has happened to billions of people on this planet. Because we were told, you know, work, create the life you want, and sit back. That's not real. Be obsessed. When he finally got where he thought he was going to be, he quit setting new goals. What actually got the guy what he wanted, he quit doing. You understand? He thought he wanted the golf and the lazy boy and the time off and the beer, and then found out, I don't want that. What got him to that place, he quit doing. So, of course, his life is going to deteriorate. As a result, this individual loses his or her way. Look, just as you reboot a computer by restarting it and reloading the operating system, all people must reboot the purpose and the obsession. We are all in transition. We are all getting older. We are all starting over every day. And things change. We change. Life changes. The destination changes. Conditions change. Motivation change. Purpose changes. There's disappointments. There's challenges. There's losses along the way. Look, if you don't stay obsessed with where you are going, you will become that person you don't want to be. Lost, jaded, stuck in losses, stuck in yesterdays, and wasting away today's and your future. Look, I've been there. I struggle with this all the time. I've done it, been there, done that. Don't want to keep doing it, but I know I have to. I have to keep paying attention. When I didn't know why I was getting up every day, I felt like I was dying inside. Have you ever felt like that? Why am I going to work? Why am I doing this? Why am I married? Why am I being a father? Why am I writing this book? Why am I reading this audio program? Look, if you don't know, you're going to die. You're dying inside. You're deteriorating. It's like you cut the apple, nobody eats it. What happens to it? It goes brown. It did not fulfill its purpose. Purpose will keep me and you from spending a lifetime wandering around planet Earth, lost, without direction. Real purpose and obsession with that purpose will keep you from wandering around like, what's happening here? So that you always understand your purpose and what you should be obsessed with at any given time in your life. Let's talk about igniting the power, that power inside of you. By every day writing your goals down. From the floor. Straighten your arms as much as you can. Daily goal practice. Okay, I've been doing this for years. Every day I write my goals down. I've talked about this in every book I've ever written. It's so vital. It's so important. It's so enriching. Writing goals down daily is a great tool for staying focused, recommitting, and rebooting. Because, again, understand, the destination changes. As this plane goes through the air from Miami to Las Vegas, it must readjust. just renavigate along the way. There's other planes. There's other activity. There might be some weather. I have to change. I have to alter my trip just a bit. And I have to keep in mind why I'm going where I'm going. Just because I get to Vegas doesn't mean I get to Vegas. You understand? I got onto the plane with a certain intention, and I got off the plane, and I forgot my intention on the plane. That's life. So your job and my job, the successful, the super successful, the geniuses know how to reboot constantly. This is going to also help you keep track, rewriting your goals, keep track of how far you have come from where you first started. And most importantly, this practice is going to keep your attention on what is possible. See, yesterday's achievements don't fulfill anybody tomorrow. Ask any super successful person. Ask an actor that did a movie 3 or 4 years ago. Ask a comedian that was doing a routine 3 or 4 years ago about that. Hey, tell me that joke again. Ask Jay-Z about a song he wrote 12 years ago compared to the song he's launching right now. You're stuck in the past. He's not. First, let's clarify what I mean by goals as opposed to purpose. Goals are something you seek to achieve. I want to grab that money. I want to get that girl, right? Whereas purpose is the reason I want the money and the reason I want the girl. See, your North Star, your reason why you do what you do. Why am I going to Vegas? Vegas is the destination. In order to stay obsessed with your true purpose, you need to be obsessed with setting and hitting your goals and continuing to feed your future. I want to feed the future, if you will. I feed my refrigerator. For what? For the future. I started writing down my goals the night I returned from rehab. I remember I sat down and just started writing down the future of my life and got off the pass. Look, the pass is for psychotics. In order to get focused on what you want to create in your life, you've got to keep looking at your goals all the time. Since then, since 25 years old, I have probably written my goals down, I don't even know how many times, 30 years, hundreds of thousands, millions of times. And not just at night, but first thing when I wake up in the morning. I have a legal pad to keep it by my bedside. I wake up to it, I go to sleep to it. And also, anytime I'm feeling down or lost or disappointed or discouraged, I grab my pad, I write my goals down. It puts my attention on the future. Feed your future. See, what I write, you're investing in your future mentally, right? What I write is not what you would find on a to-do list, just so you understand. This is not, I need to call Bob and John today. I need to do a deal today. I need to make some money today. This is about what I want to create in the future. When I talk about goals for the obsessed, I'm not talking about achieving activities. I'm not talking about a to-do list. I'm talking about wins that are out of reach at this time. I can't even see them. 40,000 apartments. I want to go public on the New York Stock Exchange. I want to create a REIT. I'm going to seed the REIT. I'm going to go public. I'm going to get international attention. Millions of people are going to fund this REIT. See giant things that are out of reach. I'm talking about creating a powerful future, feeding a future, if you will, that pulls me forward. It's not the law of attraction. I want the pull. I want it to pull me to it. And by the way, this is not just about talking positive in a mirror or writing stuff down. This is about massive, obsessively following up your dreams and your goals with action. You're pushing so much energy into this that it pulls you forward. See, this morning when I woke up, for instance, I rolled over in my bed. Scarlett comes in, jumps in bed. I grab my legal pad and I start quickly running my notes and my goals down. It takes 3 minutes. $4 billion in real estate holdings. I have $400 million right now. I got to 10x that to fulfill that goal. I have no idea how to do that. Okay? It seems so far off. It's almost like I look at it, I'm like, that's impossible. I don't spend time on it. Just write the next thing. Okay? And the next thing. Do not spend time on the mechanic. In fact, the faster you can write it down, the better. And just leave it. Just walk away from it. In fact, what I want to achieve X is so far off. It's further than I've come since I was 25. It seems unachievable, impossible. So just write down the next thing and throw it away. Or keep it in your legal pad. Just write. Just write. Just fuel the future. Just write it as though nothing bad can happen to you. And maybe it'll happen. Maybe not. Look, I write it down. I write it down in past or present tense. I own a $4 billion real estate trust. I own and control over $4 billion. as a desire or something I've yet to achieve, but something I have accomplished. I don't write down I want to do this in the future. I write down this is done. I own and control $4 billion worth of real estate holdings. Now, some of you have been following me for a while. Maybe you got the 10X rule, or you got sell or be sold, or maybe you saw my seminars back in the 90s when I was doing 250 seminars a year around the world. And you remember me talking about goals and how important they are. I am married to a beautiful woman. That was before I was married, okay? I have two beautiful children. That was way, way before I had two beautiful children. I have two beautiful children that love and admire me and think I'm Superman. All that happened way before. I owned 20 apartments. I own 4,000 apartments today. See, I was writing all that down before I achieved it. So you got to keep feeding this future, if you will. Look, if you're committed to feeding your future, tweet me. I'm feeding my future at Grant Cardone. Hashtag be obsessed. See, I believe that my mind, and I believe your mind, accepts everything as a reality. It just believes whatever you tell it to believe. I'm a nasty person. Your mind says, okay, let's roll. I'm hungry. Let's roll. I need to eat more. Let's roll. I can't work out. Let's roll. See, your mind basically just accepts whatever data you give it. When I started this daily ritual over 25 years ago, I wrote down, I own 20 apartments. This was the first time I ever did it. I own 20 plus apartments. I don't even know where that came from. I didn't own apartments. I've never read a book on apartments. I've never done any research on apartments. I have no clue. As I sat there and wrote as fast as I could, where it came from. The next day it showed up again. 3 days later it shows up again. 3 months later it's still on the path. A year later it's on the path. Okay? Now also throughout that period of time, other things would go. I'm in the perfect shape of my life. That would come and go. Every other week it would show up and it would go away. It was never there all the time. That 20 apartments, dude, it was there every day. My first apartment deal was 8 years later, and it was 38 units. Okay? 30 days later, I bought 48 units. 60 days after that, I bought 92 units. Literally within a period of like 4 or 5 months, I had bought over 100 units, and my goal was 20 apartments or more. I don't even know why I was writing it down. Maybe because it was buried deep in, so deep inside of me that I never even thought about it every day because I was so busy, too busy, just doing a job. See, at that time, I hadn't even bought one deal. Again, I didn't know anything about apartments. I didn't know anything about management. I didn't know anything about finance. I didn't worry about any of that when I wrote it down. I don't know how to find an apartment deal, who sells apartments. I was clueless about that space. But something innately, innate, born in me, original to me, wanted me to go buy apartments. Had I not fed that future, I don't think I would have ever bought an apartment. Again, I had no idea when I wrote this down how I would accomplish the goal, any more than I knew how I would get my wife and the two girls, the two daughters that I have, okay? I mean, I got an idea how you get two daughters, but I didn't know how to get the wife I wanted. All these goals have seemed unreal to me. I'm going to write best-selling books. I wrote that for 10 years before I ever wrote a book. Still, I wrote it down. It showed up every day. I've written 7 books, 12 best-selling programs. I'm not bragging. I'm telling you, this is magic. You want magic? This is magic. Now, once you start owning apartments, you have to start learning something, right? So, now I'm looking at properties, making connections, learning everything I can about it, creating a management company, shopping on weekends, like literally, like I'm learning about the space. So, what happened was I fed my future, and the next thing you know, I'm having to learn. I'm reaching for books, grabbing information. As soon as I closed my first deal, I rebooted my goals. I remember I was writing down, I own 20 apartments. I wasn't even thinking about 4,000. I own 20 apartments. I rebooted. Oh, I can get to 100. I go get 100 in 90 days. I reboot again. Okay? I always keep feeding the future. And as I'm writing, as I accomplish the 20, I just change my goal. It just automatically changed by me having that legal path. Now I'm writing, I own 100 units that provide cash flow of over 12% a year. Now I'm getting a little fancy with my goals because I didn't even think about the cash flow when I first wrote it. Again, within 90 days of the first deal, which took 8 years, I not only achieved my 20 units, but within 3 or 4 years, I'd own 500 units. Okay? Fast forward 20 years, I own 4,500 units. People laughed at me. People laughed at me for my little legal pad. I remember I went on a retreat, a 3-day retreat where nobody talked to anybody. At the end of the retreat, the guy came up to me. The retreat just laughing at him. He's like, I see you use your little legal pad. What you write on your little legal pad, everybody? Okay. Like, dude, I'm feeding my future. The people have been laughing at me for years for keeping my little legal pad there. People have been laughing at me for years for dreaming. People have been laughing at me for years for thinking I can do things that had never been done. I'm talking family members, friends, people close to me, people that say they're my buddy. Customers have laughed at me for thinking I could transition from one industry and vertical across others. You got to be obsessed. You have to be obsessed and stay obsessed with feeding your future so that you can end up with the future that you want. I remember when a girl I was dating asked me about the legal pad next to my bed. We were just dating. And she's like, hey, what's the deal with the pad? Okay? Do you write about me in that book, in that pad, on your goals? Well, truth is, I didn't write about her. I had never written about her. I was writing about my wife-to-be. In fact, when I wrote about the girl of my dreams, the future I was feeding, the middle picture that I got looked completely different than the girl that was in my bed asking me the question. At that moment, I realized I could never see her again. And I didn't. Look, if I'd stayed with her, I couldn't have. But if I'd have stayed with her, had I stayed with her, I would have been treasonous to my dreams, my purpose, my goals, and my obsessions. Treasonous. Look, there's enough people on this planet that will hoodwink you, trick you, lie to you, betray you. Don't stand in line and be one of them. At least honor your goals and dreams and purpose. I'll give you another example to show you how this works. I've always enjoyed writing. Since I was a little kid, I remember my dad wrote calligraphy, and I guess I was fascinated with his love of writing. And I've always written, always wanted to write, I think since 6 or 7 years old. Like, maybe I had a dream one day that I'm going to write a book. One day as I'm doing my goals, I was probably 27, 28 years old. I'd been writing these goals down every day for 2 or 3 years, and it showed up. I'm a best-selling author who has won many awards for my books. I'm like, where did that come from? Next day, it shows up again. I'm like, oh, wow, I remember. I've had this goal. This dream of being a writer has been with me a long time. I wrote this every day for years. One Sunday afternoon, years after I started writing, years, I'm talking years, lots of years, okay, how about 28 years? One Sunday afternoon, I started writing my first book, Celery Soul. That book was written in under 3 hours. Like, it flooded out of me. Like, it was sitting there the whole time. That book is going on to sell hundreds of thousands of copies and earn multiple awards. Since then, I've written 6 books, plus another 12, maybe 15 best-selling self-help programs that have gone on to sell hundreds of thousands and even millions of copies, land on bestsellers lists, win awards, and even make me a little bit of money. But most importantly, what it's done is fulfill a goal that I never thought I had, that I wasn't even aware of, which was helping people. I've made friends with people all over the world, okay? The biggest thing that I've got is I didn't have friends when I was in high school. I always wanted friends. I got friends in every country on every continent on this planet today because of the work that I've done. By using this daily goal practice to remind yourself of where you're going and why, I promise you this is going to work for you. It just requires a little bit of discipline to write every day. Write your future in order to achieve your future. Other successful people do this. Look, you probably know the story about Jim Carrey, who wrote himself a check for $1 million when he didn't have $10 to his name. He took out a check, wrote Jim Carrey, to Jim Carrey, from Jim Carrey, $1 million. As soon as I saw that, I wrote myself a check for $10 million. I'm like, why didn't Jimmy write a check with a 10? Now I'm asking myself why I didn't write a check with a bill. You know what I mean? Look, the world needs more people who are obsessed. Let's face it, passionate, driven, dedicated, all in, committed, relentless people that are alive. You can't buy those things in a grocery store. You can't fake that. You cannot learn that in college. Having a great life is not going to be easy. Look, having an average life is going to be a disaster, okay? Having a great life takes effort. Having an average life is miserable. But it feels great to know where you're headed. And it feels great to know why. And that any achievement means you're one step closer or miles closer to your ultimate potential. You don't like the way I'm kicking? Kick higher. You know what I'm doing? Chapter 4, Feed the Beast. Love this chapter. Flicking the leg.
going side. Okay,
look, what you pay attention to is what you will give. And the more attention you give something, the more you feed it, the stronger and more powerful that thing grows. In life and in business, it is vital to pay attention to the things and people that are working for you and ignore those that are not. Look, success feeds me, and success will feed you. Winning feeds me, and winning will feed you. I was in a UFC fight, MMA fight, actually, and I was the corner man for Cody Williams. And he looked at me before he went in the fight. He's a bantamweight, 16 fights. And he says to me, do you have any advice? I said, Cody, I got two words for you. What is that, Graham? And I said to him, winning matters. Look, success matters. Winning matters. Productions matter. Success feeds me. Winning feeds me. Production feeds me, and it'll feed you. Reaching your potential will feed you. I make lists every day of things that make me stronger and those that don't. And I use those things to what I call feed the beast and starve out those things that cause me doubt. Many people admire my drive. They say, man, you got so much drive. My constant, nonstop, my push, my ability to stay on course long after others have taken time off. They ask me, Grant, what drives you? This might be the most important question for anyone to ever answer in their life. Look, for me, it's an ongoing, moment-by-moment effort to feed the beast and starve the doubt. You know, in Louisiana, we have this grass called St. Augustine. And St. Augustine grass is a very, it's just really coarse and thick. St. Augustine grass is so thick that it actually chokes out the weeds. That is my point about feed the beast and starve the doubt. Now, look, actually, we're not talking about beast singularly, in case you thought I was getting carried away. Now, let's go all the way there. At any given point in your life or my life, I have multiple beasts, and I want to feed them all. These are your goals, your purposes, your obsessions, in plural, that must be attended to, must be fed, they must be honored, and they must be exercised. Some of the beasts are being the most successful guy in your space. I don't know what your beasts are. These are mine. I want to be the most successful guy in my space. I want people copying me. I want them to hate me for a moment and ask me to hire them a moment later. I want to get my money so right. I'm just one of my beasts now. I want to get so much money I can have it in different denominations and I can't count it. Let's face it, if you can count your money, if you know where your money is, you don't have enough. One of my beasts is to be a great husband. I want to be a fantastic husband to my wife, Elena. I want her to think I am Superman, Batman, and Iron Man all in one. Okay? I also want to be a great father. I want to be a great father to both Sabrina, and I want to be a great father to Scarlett. And, frankly, I'd like to be a father that I think I'm obligated to be to billions of other people that don't have a father at home. Another piece that I must feed is I want to be a philanthropist. I want to give more money away, and I want to help other people give more money away. Another beast is setting a great example for others. Now, look, you don't need to hear about my beast. I got some beast. I got them all over the place. I would never have one horse. I want a fleet of them, right? I want fleets of different purposes and obsessions that keep me interested. If you feed the beast, your dreams have a chance of becoming a reality. Ignore them or deny them, and not only will those dreams never become a reality, but if you don't feed the beast, you're going to end up with all these weird, destructive, other negative obsessions that will rear their heads and pull you away from your purpose and possibly destroy your life. Look, you don't need a drug addiction to have a failure in life. You don't need to have a bunch of ugly, black, dark problems to end up with a life that is black and dark and problematic. At the very least, look, when you sit on them, on these things, these beasts that I call, and you suppress them or try to hold them down, I promise you, they will most surely contort into envy, fear, regret, and doubt. Stay focused on what allows you and your business to grow, you and your life to grow, you and your marriage to grow, and invest no time, no energy, and no resources on those things and people that don't help you grow. Feed the beast of your obsessions.
Wait a minute, no. Sidekick.
In this chapter, I want to load you up with tools you can use to literally feed the beast. Then, because doubt is biggest threat, or at least most people tell me it's their biggest threat and their biggest enemy. In the next chapter, we're going to take a look at how powerful it is to deny something your attention. You understand? You're going to literally not give that thing your attention, and we'll make it so weak that it will lose any hold it has on you. In fact, it's just going to die. Maybe it'll go spend time with someone else. When you're truly obsessed with the things that are good and you constantly feed those things, all those things yanking at you, the self-esteem issues, the introversion, the disabilities, the lies you tell yourself, the fear of success, the fear of failure, all these contradictions, these neurosis, insecure thinkings, I promise you, they're going to fall away. They're going to literally get choked out by that St. Augustine, that thick grass. Why? Because you don't care about them. You're not giving attention to them. Your attention is fully on the good stuff. You ever seen somebody driving down the road and all of a sudden everybody's rubbernecking and pulling over because somebody had a little fender bender? Hundreds of cars pull over to watch the damage of another car. I am so busy going where I'm going, I didn't even see the wreck. See, I'll never tell you I'm obsessed. Okay, I'll never tell you anything short of that. I'm obsessed with where I'm going, not with what happened to someone else on the side of the road. These are spectators. I'm obsessed. The spectators say the obsessed are sick. The obsessed say the spectators are silly. I'll never tell you anything impossible. I promise you I won't. And you should never decide anything's impossible. You know it is. A total stranger came up to me once, recently, in fact, and said to me, I understand your goal is to have 7 billion people on planet Earth know your name. I said, well, actually, now it's 7.3 billion. The next time you see me, it'll be more like 8 billion. He says, you know that's impossible, right? And I thought, this guy isn't talking to me. I literally thought to myself, this cat in front of me, the body standing in front of me right now, is not actually talking to me. He is trying to make sense of all that he has given up. He is not talking to me. He is talking to him. This very, very important lesson to understand. When your wife or husband says, your dreams are ridiculous, she is not, or he is not talking to you. They are talking to themselves. I don't need anybody to tell me that talking to 7.3 billion people is impossible. I know that. Why shouldn't I have that as a goal, though? Look, I don't have a camel. I can't talk to most of the planet because I don't have a camel. Okay? 7.3 billion people. Most of these people don't have an internet or a phone. How am I going to talk to them? I know it's impossible. Notice how distracted this individual is, that he would be locked on what I can't do. The world's filled with these people. And I'm not trying to change them. And I'm not trying to change you. I'm trying to inspire you to be who you are meant to be. To give you permission to be obsessed. Because I know I can't talk to 7.3 billion people, much less 8 billion people. I don't need anyone to remind me how difficult my goals are going to be, or even dangerous they might be. I know that. And I'm still going to go for that. Because the alternative is too painful. I don't want to be him. I've been him. I don't want to be him anymore. I've been him, and when I was him, I was drugging, I was drinking, I was wasting time, I was playing games, I was a spectator. I was disappointed with myself. Look, I'll judge myself later for coming up short. Right now, I'm going for it. You need to face, master, and channel your obsessions into an engine of massive, energized momentum for the success you desire. Set your course of possibility, and then fuel that engine with the highest octane stuff that you can possibly get your hands on. Spend money, borrow money, do whatever you have to do to fund that activity. It'll be worth it. Stay laser focused on your goals. Lots of people talk about goals as a good idea, a nice thing to do, but not me. And not any successful person I know. Goals aren't a New Year's resolution or a journal entry or a bumper sticker or an Instagram post. They're critical to your life's happiness and fulfillment. Look, I can't stress this enough. Don't write your goals down on a post-it note. I mean, if you only have a post-it note, do it, okay? But that should not be where you're putting your goals. Your goals are precious. And then take a moment to look at them. It takes me 3 or 4 or 5 minutes. I eat, I sleep, and I breathe my goals. Not because I should, but because I can't help myself now. And where I want to get you is to a place where you're writing this down every day, so it's such a discipline. You wake up in the morning, you probably go to the restroom, you take a shower, you might work out, you get some breakfast, you drive this planet that we live on. Wake up and go to sleep focused on your goals. Write them down every morning and write them down again each night. I don't write them and read them. I write them down in the morning, flip the page, write them down again that night. Once you start doing this over and over again, they're going to start growing. Okay? You're going to internalize them. You can't get away from it. It's St. Augustine grass. It's thick. Did I tell you it's thick? Look, you'll see everything around you as a means for achieving. You're going to start picking up, oh, wow, that thing over there, that person over there, that thing over there, that activity, this job will get me where I'm going. I'm telling you, you're going to start changing the way you see things and people, and you'll start seeing opportunities that can help you piece together the things you're writing down that legal pad. The moment you quit this practice, it costs nothing to do this, by the way. We actually built a little planner so that you can do it in the planner. It's called a 10X planner. The moment you quit doing this, the moment you quit practicing, you're going to find yourself falling into repetitive cycles of just being a spectator, a cog in the wheel, just another agent to do the work. And don't forget, your goals will continue to mature and change as you mature and change. And by the way, as you mature and change does not mean that you can't still be immature. No proof of that. You will not write down the same goals 5 years from now that you write down today. And if you do, you're not writing them down every day. Something's real wrong if today the goals you write are the same goals you write 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, or 20 years from now.
Cool down is important.
Roar toward the future. Keep your attention constantly focused on the future rather than the past or even the present. I don't care about right now. It's over. Okay, stay in the present right now. Boom, already over. Gone, okay? Hey, keep your attention on where you're going to be next. That is the real present because you're moving that fast. What are you going to create next? What are you going to do next? Who are you going to call next? Okay, what can you do that has never been done before? When you're driving down the road, do you look through the windshield? Or do you look through the rear view mirror? Or do you look at your feet? Okay, look at what's in your windshield and disregard the rear view mirrors. I don't get in wrecks. I have my attention all out in front of me. I see everything. I'm not looking at one thing. I see everything in front of me. My wife does not think I'm even paying attention to the road. I said, 13 years we've been together and I've hit nothing. Feed the beast. Feed the beast. It's your future. Feeding the beast will keep you locked into your future and the discovery of your full potential. For instance, as I write this, I own, as I said earlier, almost 5,000 apartments. Could be 5,000 by the end of the day, actually. And they're probably worth $400 or $500 million. When I started out, I couldn't imagine. My first purchase of real estate was $78,000. It was a little house. If you told me one day you were going to have $500 million worth of real estate, I'd be like, oh, man, you've been reading too many comic books. I remember thinking, if I can get 20 units. Now, I'm telling you this again to tell you, look, whatever goal you set today, I assure you, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years from now, you're going to look back and say, no matter how big that goal was, then if you stick with it, stay with it, become obsessed with it, feed it every day, I guarantee you, you will look back and say, wow, I should have set bigger goals. So I encourage you now, okay, go big or go home. If I could get 20 units, I'm thinking back then, if I could get 20 units, this is how small I was thinking, but it was huge to me at the time. If I could get 20 units making me a little extra money every year, boy, that'd be good. I remember thinking, if I could just get making $10,000 extra a year, it's huge for me. But that's all I can see then. So write it down. Write down whatever you can see right now. It's going to change. Your eyelids will pop open. Possibilities will take place. Because I stay with my goals. Because I discipline myself to do this every day. I have a saying that says, if it's worth doing once, it's worth doing every day. If it's not worth doing every day, it probably isn't worth doing at all. Basic things in life must be done every day. Because I stayed with it and allowed my goals to mature, okay, I kept feeding, I kept fertilizing, I kept watering these goals and expand them as I achieved targets, not just some, even though at times I did kind of start resting on my laurels, you know. And we'll be talking about that, how to handle that. Today, I'm able to think with more of what I see as my full potential because it starts rippling. It's like throwing a rock in a pond and the ripple effect happens. When a goal is achieved, it ripples out to your potential. Today, that 20 units I had years ago, you know, has now a goal of 40,000 units. You might say, well, when will you ever be satisfied? I'm never going to be satisfied, okay? You need to put the book down if that's what you're thinking and go get a book that says, I want to be satisfied. I'm obsessed with my future. Now, when I make this new declaration, when you make this new declaration, you will become temporarily overwhelmed. Trust me. Just a warning here. Oh, my God, how am I going to do that? Don't do this. Understand, I'm telling you right now, you will become temporarily overwhelmed. I said this in the 10X rule. I warn people. You write 10X, you start working 10X, immediately what's going to happen is you're going to end up with new problems, number one. Number two, you're going to have people criticize you. People call me all the time. How'd you know that was going to happen to me? I'm warning you. When you start writing these goals down, when they're the right size goals, you're going to become temporarily stymied, overwhelmed, introverted, questioned. How can I do that? Don't do that to you, okay?
Same thing.
You're going to ask yourself, how can I possibly do this, okay? I've never done it before. How can you do it? Okay, you don't know anything about it. You don't have the staff. You don't have the money. All this is going through your head like lightning speed. I don't have the connections. I don't have the information. I don't know anybody. The Wall Street guys are going to kill me if I go to 40,000 units. All that's going to go through your head. I have to deal with lawyers now and regulators and investors, and I'm going to get sued. And on and on. See, when I think of all the reasons I can't accomplish a goal, the beast goes into hibernation. The beast that I need to get me through this thing, this jungle, this complication, is not getting fed. My fears and my doubts are. At that moment, rather than going along with your fears and your doubts, simply write down the goals. Trust me right now. You don't need to trust yourself. You don't always have to trust yourself. Find someone else you can trust. You can trust Grant Cardone. I've done this, okay? Trust me. Let me be there with you, okay? Pull me into your space right now. Say, hey, Grant, come on, man. What would you tell me to do right now? Let me be your mentor, your virtual mentor, your make-believe. Hey, man, you had make-believe friends when you were a kid? Have one now? Have your Uncle GC right there with you right now. I believe you can do this. Write the goal down. Just write it down. Whatever it is, $40 billion, whether real estate, $10 billion, whatever your number is, what kind of return do you want? See, I think about, as I do this, I think about, how can I provide great housing for tens of thousands of families? Not, how can I not do it? How can I provide great jobs for people? How do I provide them with salaries? This is going to be a great thing to do. When I feed the beast, something almost magical happens every time, as opposed to feeding the doubt. I suddenly find myself seeing how I can do something over time rather than how hard or difficult or impossible it might be. You have to learn to feed this obsession or obsessions. Almost out of nowhere, I find myself in different meetings with different information, with different solutions, with people.
Open up the knees. You're going to rock your feet. Ready, go. Pick my hand. You got to breathe. Six. Seven. with you guys. Let's just hang out here in child's pose. Head down to the floor.